would like to start by introducing the first speaker, which is Professor Yolande Lievens. She is chair of the Radiation Oncology Department of the University Hospital of Ghent, and this department is one of the largest academic departments in Belgium. But she's not only chair of the Radiation Oncology Department in Ghent, she is also president of the Belgian College of Radiotherapy and Oncology, and this college focuses a lot on quality assurance and audits. But thanks to Yolande, there is also a collaboration with the Cancer Registry, and this led to a quite unique data set studying the uptake of radiotherapy in Belgium. And finally, she is also the president of ESTRO, which is our European Society for Radiotherapy and Oncology. And this is quite an important society. It has up to 6,000 members. It helps us throughout Europe to lobby for radiotherapy. And next to that, on top of that, I don't know when you do all this, she is also co-chair of HERO, and HERO stands for Health Economics in Radiation Oncology. And so Yolande, at the European level, is also looking into needs, availability, uptake of radiotherapy in Europe. Yolande, the floor is yours with your title, Radiotherapy in Belgium, an insight through the European looking glass.
Thank you very much, Karine, for this very nice introduction, and thank you very much for the invitation for having me here. It's a real pleasure to be here and to be able to kick off this meeting, which I think is indeed very important. And I want to start this meeting with guiding you through some data for Belgian radiotherapy, but set in the context of European radiotherapy. And I think before we start off this meeting, it's very important to really point to the optimal focus of our radiotherapy. This is all what we are as professionals are working towards, but I think it's important to say so. We really want to improve radiotherapy for the cancer patient. The cancer patient is really at the center of our work, of our daily work. And this ties in very nicely with the vision of the European Society of Radiotherapy, which states that every cancer patient in Europe we'll have access to state-of-the-art radiotherapy as part as a multidisciplinary approach, which is very important, I think, individualized for the specific patient's cancer, and it will be discussed later on by one of the other speakers, taking into account the patient's personal circumstances. So I think this is really important to keep in mind when we go through the older presentations, because the patient is really our focus. And this ties in also with, well, what Karine also introduced, the Health Economics in Radiation Oncology project that is driven by ESTRO, has been running for five, six years now, where the aim is to develop a knowledge base of radiotherapy availability needs and a model for costing and health economic evaluation. And actually, the project has been defined as such. We have been working on the availability. We have been working on the needs. We are actually focusing on the activity-based costing and hope to be able to start off with the health economic evaluation very shortly. And what I will mostly show you in this presentation is data from the two first work packages and see how Belgium is localized in that European context. Now, where does Belgium stand? What is Belgian radiation oncology? You see the map of Belgium here. This comes from a publication, a very nice publication from a few years ago from the group of Liège. And they looked actually at, well, how is radiotherapy in Belgium organized? Where do the radiotherapy centers are? And how could it improve for the future? This is a snapshot in time. It relates to the situation that there was in 2011. You see the primary centers in triangles, and you see the squares. These are dependencies, the so-called satellites. And as you can see, well, there are satellites that are very close to the mother hospital, but there are also satellites that are run by departments very far away from the satellite. This is a snapshot in time, as I said, in 2011. A few things have changed since, mainly in the Antwerp region, where one department was closed. A few satellites have opened. And if we overlay this picture with the distances that we have in Belgium, and certainly if we look at, compare this to the Canadian situation, for example, then our travel distances, of course, are very short. They are typically not much more than 30, 40 kilometers, especially in the north of the country, also in the region of Charleroi-Namur. If you go down to the south of Belgium, you don't have so much radiotherapy availability, but of course, the population density is much less there as well. Now, you should know that the situation is not something that has been planned. It grew organically over the years, so it's a historical representation of what has happened. And unfortunately, I would say it's also been driven by political incentives and by strategic decisions by hospitals. So I think we miss a little bit the global picture in how to advance radiotherapy for the future. So what do we have at this point in time? What do we have in terms of resources, in terms of personnel, in terms of equipment? These are data from the HERO project. So you see here the availability of mega voltage machines across Europe. You see that there are countries, and the best resourced one is Denmark, with over 9 mega voltage machines per million inhabitants. That goes down to Albania with having only, well, a bit less than 2 mega voltage machines per million inhabitants. And the average is about, well, a bit more than 5 mega voltages per million. And you see that Belgium is clearly one of the best resourced countries in terms of mega voltage equipment. If we compare that to the needs that have been prospected, well, 10 years ago already by another project of ESTRO, you can see that then at that point it was said that Europe should need about 5.5, 5.9 megavolted machines per million inhabitants. So on average we are there, but there's an enormous variability across Europe. If we then look at, well, it will not surprise you that this availability of resources is tightly linked to the wealth of a country. If you see here on the bottom, the increasing GNI per capita, gross national income, and you see the megavoltages units per million inhabitants, you see that there's an increase with the wealth of the country, and you see where Belgium is. We are really actually somewhat above this projection of the link between GNI and availability of equipment. And if we then look at the capability of the machines, the more complex, the more state-of-the-art machines in actual terms, so we looked, amongst others, to IMT-capable machines, then you see again that there's a link with the wealth of the country, and you also see that Belgium here is more or less in line with what you expect based on what the resources are. This gives you the same picture somewhat differently. In red, you can see the picture of the spread of megavoltage machines across Europe, with, again, Belgium being one of the darker countries, so better resourced. If you look at the blue, you see the radiation oncologist. You see that there we are somehow average across Europe, and the same holds for medical physicists and for radiation technologists and nurses. You know that in our country, the people who work on the machine are nurses and not radiation technologists. But you see that there's, again, quite some variation across Europe, and this is also related to the fact that in Europe, different roles and responsibilities are taken up by different professional types within radiation oncology. So this is what we have, but what do we actually need? And I think that the question is, what do we need is not really the right one. I think, again, we should wonder, what does the patient need? Where do we go for in terms of serving the patient best? And then, well, there are some data that have been started to be published in the middle of the years 2000 that mainly came from Australia in the beginning. And they have been, well, used very extensively and are accepted now as a general benchmark, that half of all patients that are diagnosed with cancer will need radiotherapy somewhere in the course of their disease. And on top of that, there will be 1 out of 4 of these patients that will have a secondary or third treatment later down the road in their disease. So 1 out of 2 patients needs radiotherapy. But we thought for Europe, it may also be interesting to compute this data for Europe, because of course the data come from Australia, and if you have a different patient population, it might give a different outcome. Now, globally in Europe, it's very close to that 1 out of 2. 51% of all patients need radiotherapy. If we then look at Belgium, and this is really related to the demographics and the incidence of our cancer patients in Belgium, you see that we are actually in Europe the country with the highest needs of radiotherapy for our patient population. And then the next question is, well, do we do it right? I mean, do we deliver this treatment to the patients that really need it? And if this would be the lowest parts, no radiotherapy, and this would be the optimum of 100%, then this is how the different countries across Europe are represented. And you see again Belgium in red. You see that we are close to 80%, which is certainly, if you look at other countries in Belgium who do not get better than 60 to 70%, really do not bad, but still, all in all, only 4 out of 5 patients in Belgium that really need radiotherapy based on the evidence actually get it. And you should know that these data are really bulk data. We looked at global data from the reimbursement figures, and we compared it to the optimal. So we thought, together with the College of Radiotherapy and the Belgian Cancer Registry, that we maybe could do it more refined, because this is really a bulk approach. And so for that, we did another study where we really tracked each individual cancer patient with a single diagnosis of cancer. And we looked at a cohort of 2009-2010, and we tracked them 5 years over time by linking them to the MTD, so the multidisciplinary discussions, and see what radiotherapy was advised. And we also looked at what radiotherapy was actually delivered by linking it again to the reimbursement figures, but then really on a patient basis. And again, you see that while this is the total data, in black you have the optimum, in red the actual, and in green the advised radiotherapy, where there's a range of uncertainty that is represented here. And all in all, you see for all different tumor types that mostly we deliver less radiotherapy than based on the evidence would be advocated. This gives you the data for the top five cancer types, which is breast, head and neck, lung, prostate and rectum. And you can see again here the advised radiotherapy, the actual and the optimal. And actually there are a few big cancer types that are very close to the optimum, and that's breast, head and neck, rectum. So we provide actually almost the radiotherapy that the patients need. But if you look at other tumor types, and especially prostate and lung, are quite far away of the evidence-based radiotherapy utilization. So there's still work to be done, and I think this is part of the awareness that, amongst others, this kind of symposium wants to highlight. So with these data, which are probably more refined than the ones that we use in the European picture, only 72% of Belgian cancer patients receive the radiotherapy that they need. And then we're focusing a bit more on some of the data, and it's impossible to show you all the data because, as Karine said, there's really a huge amount of very interesting data that we are actually still analyzing. But this shows you the data for breast cancer, and as you can see, well, the vast majority, of course, of radiotherapy is given in the early stages. It's mostly external beam radiotherapy, some are with combined brachytherapy. There's very little brachytherapy only, so intraoperative brachytherapy, accelerated partial breast, is not really taken up yet in the Belgian context. And this is a very striking picture, I think. It also comes from the Belgian Cancer Registry, which shows you that the optimal uptake of radiotherapy in breast-conserving radiotherapy should, of course, be somewhere between 90 and 100%. And you see that the vast majority of departments or of hospitals, this is hospitals, do align with this, but unfortunately that hospitals who have a lesser incidence of breast cancer patients or who see less breast cancer patients do not conform to these standards. And this is really something I think we should work on. Excuse me. So the next step is then, well, what does this mean in terms of the future? Where will we evolve with our needs of radiotherapy? And this gives you again a picture of Europe. And it has projected the needs of radiotherapy by 2025. And as you can see, Belgium is somewhere again in the middle. We have computed that about 20% additional radiotherapy treatments will be needed by 2025. And if we translate this in actual treatments, this means that in 2025, we will need to deliver 7,000 more radiotherapy treatments, which is quite substantial, and which means that we should start thinking on how to cope with these additional demands. This is, of course, not globally or evenly divided over all cancer types. Again, for example, if you look at the big five, breast cancer and head and neck will grow in demand less substantially than the average. The average in Europe, this is data for the whole of Europe, is 16%. Breast and head and neck is somewhat lower, but lung, prostate, and rectum will have a high demand over the coming years. So this kind of data, we need them to, I think, be prepared for the future. We cannot just sit there and think that things will just go on as it should. We should be prepared to try to cope with this evolving evolution. So, and for that, we need good cancer plans. Cancer plans define that we should know where are we now, where do we want to be, and how do we get there. I've already discussed the three first points with you, and in the last minutes that are devoted to me, I will just give you a quick view on what is the cost of radiotherapy in Belgium and the reimbursement modalities. I will not really go too much in detail of that, because I think we are really, really in the past here. This is the norms of radiotherapy. This is the regulatory frame for radiotherapy in Belgium. It was defined in 91. This is 25 years ago. You will see the presentations of the ones who come after me. Things have changed enormously. So we are really, really back in time here. And we are not much better for the radiotherapy reimbursement. This was defined in the late 90s, and it was actually put into practice in 2001. So we have work to do. This has to be optimized and optimized to the optimal situation to date. And I refer here to the data that were already shown also by Steven, that show you indeed that about 5 to 10% of the cancer, of the global healthcare budget is devoted to cancer care. And again, of this cancer care budget, only 5 to 10% is devoted to radiotherapy, which boils down, and I'm happy that we use exactly the same figure, to about 0.5% of the total healthcare budget being, being allocated to radiotherapy. So the cost of radiotherapy in Belgium, we had a very nice collaboration with the Healthcare Knowledge Center and also with the National Institute for Health and Disability Insurance, where we looked into, and all the professionals of radiotherapy I should absolutely mention, we made a time-driven cost calculation program, and we tested it in 10 Belgian radiotherapy departments. And the first question was actually to try to cost the more advanced radiotherapy techniques that we use, and one of the ones was SBRT, stereotactic body radiotherapy. And this gives you one of the data of this report. And as you can see, well, these are the 10 different departments. The colors denote different complexity of the treatments. You can see that if you deliver more fractions, obviously the cost will go up. And while sometimes more complex techniques will have a higher cost, but this is definitely not always the case, blue and green are more complex treatments. So this was the basis for a provisional reimbursement that we have now for SBRT, and as far as we are aware at this point, I think this will be expanded for one more year. And this brings me then to the variability of the cost. You've seen the variability of the cost of SBRT. The major driver there in SBRT was, well, also difference in uptake, time of uptake of the novel technology. Departments who are more used and who have been implementing the technique have typically lower cost than the ones who just start. This is a learning phase. But I think we also have to be very aware of the variability of our patients. We cannot just apply one treatment is the same for each type of patient. Even in breast cancer, post-operative breast-conserving treatment, you see that there's a large variability of the costs, but it really reflects the difference in technology that we use, and you should be aware that there is no one-size-fits-all. We really have to adapt the optimal radiotherapy to each patient. And this is actually what one of the last things that I would want to give you, because we have been struggling a little bit over the last few months with budget cut that was imposed on us, and which was actually taken from the former slide where it said, well, the cheapest radiotherapy you can deliver for breast is about 3,000, so let's give 3,000 for each cancer patient. Now, the actual cost is a variability of what you see on top there, 3,000 to 7,000 euro. What the actual reimbursement, if we really would use it as it was defined in 2001, which nobody does anymore because it doesn't fit anymore, it's less than 3,000 euro. If we use the actual technology that is recommended now, we are reimbursed somewhere around 4,000 euro. And what, well, I have to be fair, there's also 25% that comes in through the hospital budget, so it comes on top of that. But they wanted to cut it down to 3,000 euro. And actually, we were quite shocked by this, because this really is not what we aim for. It does not take into account technology evolution that we have had. It does not take into account the accuracy, the quality, the safety of our treatments, the things we are working for each and every day. It doesn't take into account the personalized approach in radiotherapy that we too want to deliver, just as medical oncology, for example. So, if you ask me what is the way forward, I think we still have quite a lot of work to do. One of the things I think is to really map radiotherapy in Belgian oncology and see how we interact with multidisciplinary oncology care, because as you've seen, awareness of radiotherapy is certainly one of the problems that we still have in our Belgian context, and therefore I think the multidisciplinary arena is very important. We have to define Belgian regional radiotherapy needs. We have a Belgian idea. Maybe we should cone it down to more specific areas in Belgium. We have to actualize the norms, who go back to 25 years. I think we have to start thinking in line with what the government wants. Is there a kind of leveling in radiotherapy, or are there certain kinds of treatments that should be given in certain departments? If that is the case, we also have to work on quality indicators we actually are doing with the College of Radiotherapy. Think about if an accreditation system is something that we should implement. And then also, of course, and this is also one of the endeavors of the coming years, to optimize the reimbursement system. And with that, I would like to thank the groups with whom I've been collaborating most, and I want to thank you for your attention.